Gun owners of Reddit, what is your reason to own firearms? I was robbed at knife point on my 18th birthday, the tweaker pushed the blade against my stomach sideways. I threw up my arms to the side and said, "Whoa man, I don't have a weapon," and he just looked me up and down and said, "All right," backed off, and proceeded to take all my stuff. I'll never forget how helpless I felt in that moment. And when he punched me in the face afterwards on his way out of the hotel room, and I just cried alone in the corner. I have carried a knife every single day of my life since, and if California would allow it would carry a pistol as well. I definitely enjoy target shooting as a hobby, but after being a victim of violent crime being at least marginally proficient in tools for self-defense feels critical to me. Those tools also include verbal de-escalation and crisis intervention skills, which should always be the first line if at all possible. Same. A guy chased me down a casino hallway in Vegas after he saw me cash out thousands. As I ran, I thought about all my options and none of them were good. Can't stop to knock on doors. No one is gonna help anyways. Can't use the phone on the wall. Can't use my cell. All I could do is make it to the stairs and run all the way down to the bottom floor. After that I bought a gun and I feel I have options now. If someone tries a home invasion I can decide the best course of action instead of just hoping to comply my way out of it. We didn't even have a town. We had a library, a post office, a gas station, and an antique shop that opened on the whim of the owner. On the other end of the county was the courthouse. There were two police officers and a dispatcher, sweet old lady, for the county, and they operated out of the courthouse or the library depending on what end of the county they were on. It's a long, narrow county, with nothing but back roads from one end to the other, so it would be about a 40-minute drive if you didn't want to wrap yourself around a tree or a deer. Dialing 911 or the local non-emergency number both went to the same sweet old lady. Luxury. We had a tatty old paperback, Carl on his bicycle, a backpack full of stale graham crackers, and on Thursdays if you were lucky you could trade a candy bar for a pudding cup. On the other end of the state was a judge's favorite fishing spot. His cousin Janet, bitter old cow, might yell at her husband Maurice to bring his shotgun down the wooded dirt track which took 2 days if he didn't get lost or drunk. Dialing 911 might get you Maurice but you gambled on his mood when he got there. Paradise. We don't have a town or a police department. We had one part-time constable who died 40 years ago in a tragic barn fire and his position has never been filled. Calling 911 only rings the late constable's widow who cries at the mere mention of law enforcement and becomes inconsolable for hours on end. If we are going to be murdered, we must send a certified letter to the coroner's office, which is in the next state over, so that they will add us to the waiting list of murder victims that need disposed of. And we must send a money order along with the letter to prepay for the coroner's service. We dreamed of having a backpack full of stale graham crackers and candy bars. I grew up around guns. My father owned guns and we were taught that they were not toys. Before we could ever use them, he required us to receive formal training in their use. I have grown up respecting them as tools. About 12 years ago, my wife, son and I were coming home from picking up two of my son's friends so they could spend the weekend with us. We came home to find two men robbing our house. I held the two thieves at gunpoint while my wife called the cops. We live in a rural town near a river and there is only one bridge across the river about 10 miles away. It took the cops nearly 20 minutes to get there. What would have happened if I wasn't armed, I can't say, but I can say I am forever glad they chose to comply with my commands and didn't escalate the threat, and I never was put in a position to have to fire. Number 1 is also my first reason. Grew up in a hunting house, not fanatical, but we hunted pheasant and deer in season, where guns were part of childhood education, with absolutely zero tolerance for even joking about how they could be misused or mishandled. Some are heirlooms and others are for use at the range or in hunting, but they are all locked in a gun safe with trigger locks, etc., etc. I don't at all understand anyone casually toting a gun around like a toy. As for number 2, I'm sorry that happened to you. I can't imagine the adrenaline terror of that situation. It's lucky for everyone that you were all able to walk away. When we arrived, they had their truck backed up to the front deck and were carrying out stuff and loading it into their truck. I waited for them to come out of the front door, pointed my gun at them and told them to drop our stuff and keep their hands up in the air. They did as I asked and we stood there face to face for an eternity. We could hear the sirens in the distance and it took forever for them to get there. As soon as they pulled into the driveway, I put the gun on the ground, put my hands in the air and backed away from the gun. The cops cuffed me and my wife as well as the two thieves until they could sort out what was going on. I feel like many people that do not own guns don't understand this. I shot my first gun at 5.22, but before my dad even let me hold it unloaded, I had to pass the basic firearm safety test that he gave me. I always forget that some of my friends never got the same, and when I had them a gun, their finger goes straight on the trigger and they start waving it around at everyone for the 0.01 seconds they have it before I grab it back and yell at them. Honestly, not just for women. I love where we live, but I'm out in the country and we don't have a police department. We have one state officer that patrols this part of the county and response time is usually 15 plus minutes. I hate the boogeyman reason for a gun, and I never thought anything would happen since it's such a small town, but a few years back our town actually made national news. A young man went crazy and broke into a random home down the street from us and murdered one person and left another seriously injured. He was on the run for a few days. Evidence of him showed up in the woods about 2 miles from my house. That first night, local news said all residents should be on the lookout and keep their doors locked. He broke into another home in our town, killed an old man and then stole his car and fled the state. Never ever thought that would happen here. I've always had a gun, but now I feel like my reason is way more justified should anyone ask. To anyone who calls BS on owning a gun for self-defense and that you can just run away or call for help, I dare them to count to 5 minutes while they or their family is under the threat of someone trying to cause them harm. I don't ever want to use my gun, but it's there to keep us safe in the event something were to happen. I also enjoy shooting targets and clay, so it's not just for defense. Most of my guns are heirlooms I've inherited and restored, and I love to see that old wood come back to life and those dingy barrels shine up. One I'm not sure what to do with is my grandfather's L.C. Smith double-barreled 12-gauge that he used to put food on the table. He fired it without realizing there was a mud dauber nest in one barrel and blew both barrels apart. He sawed it off one too short to be legal, and although the serial number shows it to be much older than we thought, 1902, I think, it's just a few years too young to be exempted by the ATF. Dear ATF, I'm no longer in possession of the barrel. Rural Maine. My 12-year-old niece was walking the orchards on our farm one late afternoon and came across a random guy hanging out on our property. We lived on a busy road and sometimes had transients hanging around. She ran to our house, which was closest. Her mother's farm was adjacent to ours. We called the cops and told them we had a prowler. An hour and a half later, no show, so we call dispatch again. We were told the cops drove by and saw the lights were on in the house, so they assumed everything was okay. Because you only get murdered in the dark. That last point is important. Even if you live in a big city, cops can take a long time to show up, even if your call is literally you screaming that someone with a gun/knife is breaking into your house while shouting, "I'm going to kill you." If you call because you think that someone shady is lurking on your property, it can be 20 to 30 minutes, and in the meantime that person might start to break into your house. Meanwhile, you can't get back on with 911 to report that things have escalated. Nothing quite like getting hold music or a busy signal when calling 911 to make you think about getting a gun. Really, I've had that happen trying to call the LAPD. Then, if you live out in a rural area, you might be 30 minutes away, at a minimum, from cops arriving regardless of the circumstance. Growing up, my parents had a cabin in northern Arizona and the closest cops were literally a 40 minutes drive away. Can't really count on that help arriving to save you from man or beast. I live near DC, MD suburbs. I have been put on hold by 911. Also, the dispatcher you get might have to transfer you to another department. Also had that happen multiple times, though I was usually driving for that. I called the cops once because our upstairs neighbor was screaming no, no, no while it sounded like the furniture was being rearranged. It took them 20 minutes to show up. And let's just say they didn't race into the building. Yes, sorry, I'm not putting my kids' lives at risk when seconds count. Yup, can confirm, as a kid my mother and I were in a cabin way back in the piney woods with her boyfriend at the time. Well, her boyfriend's ex showed up with a little muscle. Called the police and barricaded the door behind her boyfriend, who got fucked up outside. I remember hiding as an 8-year-old while some guy outside repeatedly tried to kick the door down. Took a good half hour till the cops got there. And there were enough dirt back roads the people got away. Wish we'd have had a 12-gauge, thankfully it was a log cabin so the door was as solid as it could get. Lot of anti-gun people live in the cities I've noticed, so this distinction is never in their minds. This might not be your typical answer, but I consider shooting a lifetime sport and I don't like golf. I've shot many competitions, IDPA, USPSA, 3-gun, skeet, etc., and I've gained a lot of appreciation for honing my skills and talking about the technical details with like-minded individuals. Obviously the general image is a white male between the ages of 21 to 50, but I've shot competitions with everyone from a 12-year-old girl who went on to compete in the Olympics, to my shooting team of all Filipino Americans, except for me, Whitey, to 80 and 90 year olds, one of which only had one arm and could outshoot any of us with a pistol. Obviously, guns are a hot political issue, now more than ever. But a lot of gun owners see it as a tool for sport, whether that be hunting, target shooting, or competition. Shooting is very zen, breath control, focus. A controlled squeeze until you're surprised the gun went off. A thing that rewards study and practice. Discipline, a lot of thinking goes on, well before you even point, no less put finger on trigger. 3. Commitment, you own what you've practiced, trained on, and stand by, You're not making a juvenile impulse purchase on a Challenger or a hot tub or a jet ski, you're sending 55 grains of lead that cannot be recalled, and that's a huge responsibility. This should be very sobering, and met with a very heavy weight of responsibility. You should have nightmares where you're not checking your backstop, not sure of why you're shooting. Only then should you be given the privilege, not a right imho, to own a weapon like a modern firearm. Appends on the gun. I've got a little .380 Browning Black Label for home and personal defense. I've got two shotguns, one is a Saiga 12 for competition shooting and a Mossberg 590 Shockwave for the house. I have a Remington 700 for competition shooting, and if the world goes to shit it'll work for hunting, as well. I have a Uberti reproduction of the 1878 Cattleman II for history's sake. Impractical today, but a lot of fun on the range. I have a Henry Big Boy in the same caliber as the Cattleman, so I only need one type of ammo between them, which is important with the ammo shortage of today, because I figured I might as well flesh out the cowboy theme. I have a good, old-fashioned M1 Garand, again for history's sake. I also have a Glock 22 for competition shooting. And, yes, I do have an AR-15 for a number of reasons. The first of which being it is similar to the weapon I carried for 21 years of my adult life, it's one I'm most comfortable with, know the most about, and can wield like it is an extension of my arm. The second is because when I was active duty military, I was lucky if I could get to the qualification range once a year, and marksmanship is a perishable skill, use it or lose it. If I wanted to maintain my qualification, I needed to train on my own dime, so I bought a similar rifle and regularly took it to a range. The third reason is, even though I'm retired now, I can still be recalled to active duty at any time for any reason, and I feel it is my responsibility to ensure I can still meet the standards should that happen. And in case anyone cares, everything but the .380 is kept in a safe, and not even my wife knows the combination. I live in the country and maintain a large ranch. My husband is often away and having a gun in the house makes me feel secure. The sheriff is not known for making quick trips, the neighbors have called before and it takes at minimum 20 minutes, during which time any number of things could happen. Aside from predators and meth heads who have both been known to trespass with impunity, I love squirrel, rabbit, and venison which are all difficult to catch. I also process my own livestock and since I don't raise them in confinement, a bullet to the brain is the quickest and most humane way to drop them. It doesn't require me to hold them down like a captive bolt gun does, extremely stressful for the animal not to mention virtually impossible when the animal in question is extremely strong and panics in confined spaces, and they literally never know what hit them. I've had to put down injured animals as well, which is horrible, but a well-placed bullet makes it less hard on both the animal and myself. I hunt, sport shoot, the self-defense argument is low on the list but still there. I also love the history and sheer engineering genius of some actions. Collecting firearms has been a really rewarding hobby, not to mention a lot of my rifles have doubled in value since I got them due to them not being made anymore and surplus stock being bought up. Most of mine are older military rifles, and by looking up the smithying marks you can tell when and where each was made. For example, I have a Russian Moisen Nagant, garbage tier rifle I know, that was made in 39, so it more than likely shot a Nazi or someone Stalin didn't like.